Good morning to all of you. You know what happened was that when we were looking for topics for these Saturday webinars, I came upon this thing of stress, because of late I was watching that things like stress, depression have literally become fads. People are flaunting things like stress and depression and all that as though it's some sort of a qualification or some sort of achievement. Yes, I am depressed, I am under stress and things of that sort. So I thought, and also the way stress is to be handled at a practical level is generally, I have seen, narrowed down to specifics. People who are spiritual talk only about spiritual means of dealing with stress. People who are into sports and gymming and jogging and all that talk only about those things. I thought maybe I can give a more holistic and all-encompassing idea about how stress is, what it is, and how it comes out, and all that sort of thing. So while I was preparing for it, since most of my colleagues happened to be women, they said that no, this week it is International Women's Day on Monday, so when you're speaking on Saturday, you should talk about stress about women only and not about men. So the poor men, you know, you are going to be left out. When we have the International Day of Men, maybe I'll take up how men get stressed up and I'll give you a few tips. Right now, we are going to focus on the stress with regard to women. In general, if you ask, you know, a typical woman would say that all my stress is because of men. And if you ask any typical male, he will say all my stresses are because of the women in my life and things like that. As I said, we are all becoming sort of cliched. That sort of thing. Even a simple fact like celebrating International Women's Day. But I keep wondering, why is it that we need to celebrate only one out of 365 days? In fact, just before we began, I was seeing the chat box and I saw Prema saying that Happy Women's Day to all the lovely women. I said, why don't you say Happy Women's Day to all the grouchy men also? We should also celebrate Women's Day. No, why have that exclusion and separate out and say, you know, send greetings only to women on Women's Day? Let men also participate in this thing. Why I'm saying this is because when we talk about stress, it has a lot to do with your interpersonal relationships. Great amount of our stress buildup is based on how we interact and deal with people. If you are getting, overloaded with work, let's say, the amount of work that you are doing is increasing, be it as a homemaker at home or be it part of some corporate or office or whatever it is, your stress does not depend on the workload. Your stress depends on what probably your boss or your customer is going to tell you. If you have a good boss who's very understanding, you can do the same work with less stress. If you have customers who, you know, don't unnecessarily make a racket and shout at you or something of that sort, you can do your work with much less stress. But if you've got people who are not very, considerate, and they are going to create problems for you and things of that sort, the same amount of work, the same quality of work tends to become stressful. One of the things which I keep harping upon is that please understand and bifurcate prevention of stress and management of stress. Prevention of stress is the first level. To whatever extent, from time to time, day to day, month to month, year to year, we should keep on making efforts on minimizing our stress. Some amount of stress is always good, what behavioral scientists refer to as eustress, the good stress. The minimum stress which makes you perform, without which you won't really bother putting in your efforts and all that, because nobody cares and you're not answerable to somebody and all that. So you're leading a stress-free life, but your performance is not at all very good. But that minimum stress is what makes you perform, what makes you achieve, what makes you ambitious and those sort of things. But when it goes beyond that, what happens? It converts into what behavioral scientists refer to as distress. So eustress is the good one, distress is the bad one. And colloquially, whenever somebody uses the word stress, they are actually referring to distress. That is the second part of the stress. That is when stress starts overwhelming you. Now, since the focus is on women, let me also tell you that women who are more right-brained, and many women are right-brained, many more compared to the men, that is, people whose primary intelligences are in the realm of emotional, interpersonal, creative, spatial, literary, intuitive. If these are your strengths, then your ability to keep your stress level down is much better than those who have left brain characteristics. That is mathematical, logical, analytical, sequential, critical, intrapersonal, experiential. These are the traits which are good. In fact, most of the achievers are left-brained. The whole education system and even the corporate world and all these things focus primarily on left-brain characteristics. So as far as achieving, not only in academics, but even in your job and your career and your corporate life and things of that sort, left-brain does help you. But then left-brain people tend to accumulate much more stress than the right-brained people. So hearty congratulations to this vast majority of women who are primarily right-brained. Don't ask me whether it is genetic or a learned phenomenon. I'm not a neurologist or a scientist. Let the scientists keep exploring. So far, they've not been able to come out with a confirmed answer to whether this left-brain, right-brain characteristics, multiple intelligences and all that, whether they are inherited, whether they are genetic, or whether they are learned and we experience them and therefore develop those things. Let them keep researching on that. One thing I do know is that many of these right-brain characteristics can be developed, nurtured, and improved upon. And that is one way you can keep your stress levels down. You can keep, your ability to manage things which are going to happen in the future in a much better manner, so that tomorrow, if there are challenges, there are hurdles, there are roadblocks, whether you succeed in that or not, whether you find a solution to that or not is different. But you will not get unduly stressed out. You will not go into that realm of distress where it starts showing up on you. I'm sure most of you are aware, but just as a revision maybe, let me tell you that stress affects you both bodily and mentally. Bodily, you start getting more tired with the same type of activity. Sometimes your sleep gets affected. Your appetite, your digestive system starts playing up. Some people start getting migraines, low back pain and neck pain, and those sort of things start happening. These are all physical ailments or physical problems, which, as your doctor will tell you, get aggravated because of stress. There may be a physiological element to that. When you suffer from indigestion or ulcers, there is something organic happening inside your stomach and your intestines. But it's aggravation. It's increasing or, going out of control is more to do with your mind than to do with your body. I have been a very strong believer that the mind has immense control over the body. And a lot of bodily symptoms which people face are to do with the mind. Go and ask any expert cardiologist. He will tell you that people who come to him with heart attacks and those sort of things are people who have accumulated stress and they didn't realize it. Which brings me to another very important point. Of late, research has shown that stress is cumulative. What does that mean? Let me explain. You start life on a clean slate. When you are a small child, life is very pleasant, unless you've been through some harrowing experiences in childhood, unfortunately. Most of those who have managed to have a smooth and a comfortable childhood, their stress levels obviously are very, very low. They are enjoying life, they are playing, they are fantasizing, they are keeping their life open and feeling very bright and pleasant, and somehow living in a sort of secure thing that nothing can trouble me. I've got my elders, my parents, teachers, they will take care of everything and that sort of thing. Now something happens where your stresses go up. Maybe your marks come down. Maybe your teacher starts scolding at you. Maybe you have some bad relationship with your parent or a sibling or something of that sort. So what happens is your stress level goes up. For some time, you start feeling very miserable. Then you resolve it. Like let's say, you have this problem with academics. So you're getting very stressed out this particular subject. I don't know whether I'll even pass in that, and I'm not being able to comprehend. I'm sitting for hours with that book and nothing is going in my brain. Stress level is going up and up and up. At the end of it, you finally manage to study reasonably well, give the exam and get marks which are more than your expectation. Now, you would think that your stress has come down to zero. No, it doesn't. If your stress had started at zero level and gone up to, let's say, 70%, when that stressor is removed, it comes back to 5 or 10% L. The next time that you are facing something which is stressful, you are starting from level 10, not from level 0. The third time when you are starting, you are probably starting from level 15 or 25. So that is what happens. I just want you to understand that as life goes on, there's a lot of accumulated stress. Please be aware of that. And since I'm addressing women, let me also tell you that many of you may have gone through some sort of experiences in your growing years and in your youth and all that, where you felt that justice is not being done, you're not getting your due, or somewhere, you're not being treated equally or properly or whatever it is. Or you've been feeling constrained, be it your parent or your spouse or somebody, who's controlling you too much and you do not have the freedom to do what you want. When all these things keep happening, please remember that you have accumulated all this stress which is sitting inside you, and you have to work beyond that. So there are two levels at which we need to manage stress. One is what you do on a day-to-day basis to bring down your stress levels, or ensure that your stress levels do not go beyond a certain point, so that you know you don't start getting more and more dysfunctional as your days and as your years keep going past. The second half is to go into the causes, the stressors, as we call it. What causes stress? Is it because of a toxic relationship? Is it because my career is not going well? Is it because my health is giving me problems? So to whatever extent we can resolve the cause, we know that we are in a better position to deal with whatever stressors come in the future. I will talk to you about both these aspects. The first one, let us talk about on a day-to-day basis, how do you deal with the stress? We start off with very, very simple things. I told you there are people who talk about spirituality, there are people who talk about very scientific ways of managing stress and all that. I do have the highest regard and respect for them. But I feel that we can even start off with some of the very, very simple things. I'm, you know, unfortunately, always been a rancho and never a chatur. Wherever I found that there is something which can be done simply and in a very smooth manner without going too deep into something, I always feel that that's a better way of doing it. You know, that prevention is better than cure, they say. Or a stitch in time saves nine, all those proverbs you must have heard. Taking all that into account, let me, you know, list out some of the innovative ways of managing stress, which various people have tried out and which I have monitored or discussed with them, and I have shortlisted over the years. There are many of them. Many people have found their own innovative ways of how they uniquely handle stress. But what I will share with you today are some of the very time-proven ones which a lot of people have said, not just one odd person here and there, but which a lot of people have said that, yes, these are the type of things which help me. Now, in this list that I'm going to show you, you have to select out of that what suits you. That is very important. Do not blindly copy somebody else's method. Somebody says that meditation helped me great and my stress has come down. You may just not be the meditating type. You sit down to meditate, cross-legged and close your eyes, and in 30 seconds, your mind is running havoc all over the place. So you know that you are not the meditating type. Just because somebody else benefited, don't just, you know, run behind that thing. So it's very important that you find your own ways, and that's the reason why I'm sharing with you today some very, very unusual, very simple, and some of them so ridiculously simple that you may even laugh at me. So let's start off with that list. Sunita has prepared them it for you, and here she is. Shouting loudly or singing in the bathroom, something of that sort. You can innovate, you can find different ways of modifying, adapting, or whatever it is. But when you can shout at nobody in particular, I'm not talking about shouting at somebody whom we are angry with, because that can lead to even worse issues. But I'm just saying, by yourself, shout. In fact, I had a friend of mine who was deep into theater and all that. He used to bring his trainees and his you know, team members to our Manthan camp. In the night, they used to spread out daris, and after midnight, because nobody gets disturbed, we have, at that time particularly, we had nobody in a vicinity of half a kilometer around. He used to encourage his people to scream at the top of their lungs. 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. He used to have this thermoses full of tea and coffee and water and all that. They used to just keep drinking that, and they used to scream their head off, and they used to feel nice. Same thing with bathroom singing. The next one is what you must have seen some people doing. We have these laughter clubs. Some people laugh at the laughter clubs, but some people have found a lot of benefit in it. Try it out and see. I'm sure there's some laughter club nearby in Artinagar where I stay. We have a morning batch of men in a BDA complex. They do a lot of things. They do that, you know, deep breathing, and they do laughter, they do shouting, screaming, whatever it is. You adapt to yourself, but laughter is definitely a therapy. There is no doubt about it. Those who have not read, please read the book by Norman Cousins, Anatomy of an Illness. He shows the importance of laughter and how it can actually, you know, cure some of the very, very serious ailments and things of that sort. So keep laughing as much as you can. Then, something very simple. I know most of you have now stopped subscribing to newspapers, so maybe I'm, you know, still living in the past. But if you do manage to catch hold of some newspapers and keep it, take a newspaper and start tearing it up. Depending on the type of person you are, you either, you know, systematically start shredding it, maybe into strips and then strips into little, you know, cubes and squares and things of that sort. If you're the type who'd like to just tear it from one end to the other, diagonally, this way, that way, and all that, you try it out. Try out different methods of shredding a newspaper. Since newspapers and that old newspapers don't cost much, you can have a pile of them hanging around and you can keep shredding them whenever you want. I'd like to share over here a very innovative way which a friend of mine who had done very well in the corporate world and then finally, you know, was invited to become the principal of a school. And he was thoroughly enjoying himself away from the corporate world and being with children. But unfortunately, he had these kids who were children of very big shots. And those kids were very, very horrible. They would do the worst of mischief. And our man could do nothing because he was under constraints. They were so influential that he could not punish them. One fine day, out of the blue, he found a way. When these pencils had come, been supplied to the school, he had this box of pencils lying on his table. He just picked up absentmindedly one pencil and started sharpening it. And then he sharpened the second one. And then he sharpened the third one. Before you know it, he had sharpened all the pencils in the box. And he was feeling so relaxed. It was like picking up each one of those naughty children and putting the sharpener and squeezing their neck out. He wasn't harming anybody. In fact, his teachers are very impressed with him that our principal sir even sharpens pencils and gives it to us and things. He's getting a very good name because of that also. But this is what I meant by saying that you have to find out. From then onwards, whenever pencils are supplied to the school, they come straight to the principal's room and he keeps a nice stock of pencils. Whenever the stress level goes up, he starts sharpening those pencils. Then, of course, a very, very time-proven thing in various ways, formats and this and that, starting with simple, slow and deep breathing. If you can do Shavasana or any one of those, you know, yogic postures and this and that, wonderful. The deeper you go, the more you will learn and the more you will enjoy it. But even if you're not into all those things, just do slow and deep breathing as many times in the day as possible. You have an important commitment, assignment, you're going to just start off and work. Move away from your laptop or whatever it is. Close your eyes and do deep breathing. For how long? 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes is more than enough. And then get down to your work. Take a break after some time and again try it out. Those sort of things. Then what about the active people, the outdoors people and all those type of people? Jogging, brisk walking, all these type of things. You are amidst nature as far as possible. You are getting some fresh air if it's not too polluted outside. Your lungs and your whole body is getting activated. And your mind is also getting a little bit of freedom. What about those who are musically inclined? You can hit something with a hammer. If you can start hitting it in a rhythmic manner, take a nail and start banging it into the wall. Any form of, you know, hitting something generally gets you that sort of feeling that you are pushing those things away from you. Your problems, your stresses start going away from you. Let's see what is the next one. Punching a pillow or punching a bag. See, now I'm coming to those type of people who want to physically let out steam. They don't feel relaxed till they have, you know, really hit out at somebody. Yes, Satyan has come with this wonderful quote of the Dalai Lama that he said that man sacrifices his health in order to make money, then he sacrifices money to recuperate his health, and then he's so anxious about the future that he does not enjoy the present, and result being that he does not live in the present or the future, he lives as though he is never going to die and then dies never having lived. Now, noticeably, the Dalai Lama said this for the man. Not too many women, fortunately, follow this thing. So that's their salutations to women who do so much multitasking, you know, who know how to balance. Even women working in very responsible and very committed job profiles and all that, mostly never lose touch of their personal life and their family commitments and things. And that is what keeps them much more grounded, much more rational, much more stress-free as compared to men. The next one is playing a percussion instrument. As I said, those of us who are musically inclined, if you take, there's so many of them, no? You have the tabla, the bongo, the drums, the so many of those things. Any of these things which are referred to as a percussion instrument, that means instruments which you hit with your hand, as compared to, let's say, a guitar or a harmonium or those type of things. If you are interested in those instruments also, yes, they do help. But more people have found greater stress relief by playing percussion instruments. So if you want to learn, you need not be so good as to give performances and all that. You're doing it for your own sake. And you're being musically inclined. If there are one or two people who do enjoy, you know, listening to what you are doing, so be it. If you can tie up with somebody who sings well, that person sing and you play on the percussion instrument or something like that. These are things which always help. Then, another very different and very unique thing. Put a chair in front of you. Visualize that person with whom you are angry. And start telling the person whatever you're feeling like. I am very angry with you because you did this. You never listen to me. You are always rude. You are this. You neglect me and you are insensitive. This, that. Say whatever you want to. Then get up. Go and sit in the opposite chair and visualize what reply that person would be giving you. And speak it out loudly to the first empty chair now where you are supposed to be sitting. Visualize that you are sitting there and this other person is responding. You know how this helps? This helps improve this skill which we always keep talking about, the skill of empathy. Putting yourself in the other person's shoes. Here you are putting yourself in the other person's chair. So what could possibly be the reply of that person when you think? Automatically you start thinking from his angle and that brings down your stress level. Then, pulling out weeds. You have a lovely plant, inevitably you have some weeds around it. Go out into the garden or the, you know, pots that you have or whatever it is. Look for those weeds and pull them out. It is symbolically pulling away the bad influences. The people who prevent you from enjoying your life or doing well in life. The same way the weeds are preventing the main plant from growing freely, isn't it? So when you are pulling out those weeds and throwing them away, you are literally pulling out the irritating people. The people who interfere, the people who don't allow you to progress, and you are throwing them away from you. Then those of us who like to write, and even if you have given up the writing habit, please get back to it. Write an angry letter to whoever has upset you or whoever is irritating you or whoever has hurt you and burn it. Burning is very symbolic. It is like, you know, I'm consigning to flames all these nasty thoughts and nasty emotions. With that, I'm freeing myself of that particular anger. And then, of course, the last one, that is giving hugs and taking your hugs. There is a thing called skin hunger. Our body, our skin needs touch more than it needs words. You can talk to a person for 10 minutes non-stop praising that person. It will not have the same effect as if you go and give a warm, bare hug to the person. And as you can see in the photographic collection which Sunita has pulled out, it could be to just about anybody. You see the two small children, you see this young man and woman, you see this person giving a hug to his dog, and you see the dog giving a hug to the man. Then you see that kid giving a hug to probably her grandmother or something of that sort. And here is everybody giving a hug to everybody else. Which I would like to, you know, wind up the first half of this program with a wonderful experience that I had. And after that, as we have told you, keep your pencil and paper ready. As soon as I start the second half, I'm going to run you through a very quick and simple exercise. All I want you to do is to put some marks, 2, 4, 1, 3, like that you will be listening. Yes, Satyarthi said that my grandmother used to sit in one corner of the courtyard and scrub a vessel till it shines. See how people are innovative when they find out. Okay. Now, what I wanted to share with you was this wonderful young man called Manoj, who unfortunately passed away very early. He used to run a small Nilgiri shop in the suburb where I used to stay in Sri Lanka. And he had put up such a nice poster. He said, "When I was a baby, all the women wanted to hug and kiss me. Now that I want to return the favor, they are not interested." And people used to come and laugh and you know, point out and this and joke about it. One day I was there in Manoj's shop. There was this young lady, a homemaker, who had moved in recently into the colony, and she had come there to do some shopping. And she saw this thing. And she made an angry face and said, "Mr. Manoj, come here." "You were a little scared of me." "Yes, ma'am." "No, no, come here, come out." She forced him to come out of that counter or that thing where he was, and he thought that maybe she didn't take the joke and she's very angry. The moment he came out, she gave him a nice tight hug and said, "Don't say nobody wants to return it. We will return it to you, Manoj. Have a wonderful day." And she went off. I'm sure that wherever that lady is, she knows how to manage her stress. So a quick 2-minute break. Seema is here with you and I will be back.
Hi everyone, have you ever seen me stressed? At least not in Banjara, and you won't find many of us, you know, when you come here to visit us. I don't think you'll find too much stress happening here because, you know, we really enjoy every minute of spending time here with each other, and you know, that's how it is. Now, Ali was giving you a lot of tips. We have a lot of booklets like this. This one is on stress. Many such tips are in this, and several such booklets. So whenever you happen to come and visit us here, please, you know, these are just for $20 or so. So you can come and pick it up. Another one is my favorite, and all DCA students know about is The Great Indian Woman, right? So this is also a very, very interesting read. And also, see, the best part about all these booklets is that they are so implementable, or you know, you can go and apply them immediately. So these are some of the things. And another thing is life skills. If those skills are developed in us, then I think we can handle a lot of challenging situations in life. Out of the 10 life skills which WHO has recommended, one of them is management of stress. So we are starting a program tomorrow. It's a short-term online course. It is called International Certificate in Life Skills. So tomorrow is our inaugural class, and it's going to be online from 10:30 to 12 o'clock. You can see the poster. The details are there. If you want to attend our inaugural session today, just send a WhatsApp message to our numbers. I will be sending you. I'll be texting it to you in a bit. So you can send me a WhatsApp text or to our office mobile number, and we can give you the G Suite link, right? So yeah, the number is here. So you can send a request to these numbers, and we will send you the G Suite link. Tomorrow's inaugural class, you can attend to understand, you know, what are life skills? What are we going to be doing in the 16 session program? And because it's online, people from outside Bangalore can also attend it. So that's what it is about: stress, preventing stress, and like Ali said, keep your pencils and paper ready. And back to Dr. Ali.
Thank you, Sima. That gave me an opportunity to have a quick cup of tea. Right. Would you like to actually check out how is your current stress level? This is not a, there's a disclaimer, this is not a full-fledged scientific psychometric test, but quantitatively it will definitely give you an indication whether you are stressed out or not. What I'm going to do is to show you 14 questions. Please don't bother to sit and write those questions down. Take a piece of paper or whatever the, you know, notepad in your phone or whatever it is. And for each of these questions, as I put it up, please mark according to this scale. That is, if you are always doing that, mark yourself as 4. If you are doing it often, mark as 3. If you are doing it sometimes, mark as 2. If you're doing it rarely, mark as 1. And if you're never doing it, mark as 0. So you got it from 0 to 4. 4 is always, 3 is often, 2 is sometimes, 1 is rarely, and never is 0. So read each one of them and just write down that number between 0 and 4 which applies to you on, in your day-to-day life. Let's take an example, the first one. Do you feel like giving up everything and running away? No, I never feel that way. 0. But every now and then, or very often, I feel like running away. 3. Once in a while, yeah, this thought does come to me. 1. You get me? So just read that and mark 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. Now we'll go a little faster on this. Second one, do you get frustrated by things that break down? You know, things which don't work, these sort of things. Now we are having this in these StreamYard and Zoom, suddenly the image disappears or something like that happens, or the phone call drops or anything of that sort. Do you get frustrated by things that break down? Always, often, sometimes, rarely, never. Third one. Do you find yourself irritated by petty official procedures? You know, there are a lot of places where there are official procedures, what we call as the red tape. Do you get irritated by it? Write down the number. Fourth one. Do you find it difficult to relax? You get restless whenever there's free time and you need to relax and all that. You want to get going on something. So if you find it difficult to relax, rate yourself 4, 3, 2, whatever it is. Fifth one. At night, do you worry about things that have happened during the day? At the end of the day, when you know you're about to go to sleep and all that, do you have this thing of, you know, what happened today and, oh, this didn't happen, that didn't happen, or that should have happened, and things like that. Number 6, do you have unfulfilled ambitions? I'm growing older, but I'm still not able to do this. I was so keen on doing this, but I've not been able to do that. I have missed out on this in life, and things like that. How often or when does it happen? Seventh one, do you get impatient? You know, irritable, restless, and things of that sort. Why is this queue not moving? Why is this person not answering my phone? Why is this happening? That sort of thing. Eighth one, do you wish that you could take things a little easier? I want to take things easier, but right now I'm caught up in this project or in this responsibility or my family and this and that. I just can't seem to be, you're not taking things easier. ninth one. Do you wish that people would treat you with more consideration? Nobody understands me, you know. I work so hard, I slog away, I do so much for my family, I do so much. But people are not considerate at all. How often do you feel that? Accordingly, write the number. Tenth one. Do your relatives or family members upset or annoy you? You know, the closer people who are important to you. Do you feel that they are upsetting you or annoying you? And depending on how often it happens, you can give yourself the number 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 11th one. Do you take total responsibility and not leave work unfinished? The moment I take up something, I will not let go till I have completed it. How often you do that, mark it. Number 12, do you worry when you think some people don't like you? Why is it this one is not smiling at me? Why is it that one is ignoring me? Why is it that this person purposely leaves me out of things or, you know, says bad things about you? So do you worry thinking that some people do not like you, and how often does that happen? Number 13, do you need things like, you know, tea, coffee, cigarettes, alcohol, something or the other you lean on to get you going? When I'm really stressed out, I need a smoke here, then only I feel this. Or I have one pack of this and then I feel nice. Wow, when I'm so tired, I just can't do without a cup of tea. I need that badly. And the last one, the 14th one. Do you suffer from any persistent aches or pains? It could be migraines, it could be neck pain, it could be back pain, it could be stomach indigestion, any of these things. Do you have them always, or often, three, sometimes, rarely, but never? Right, so now you have these 14 questions which you have written down. Can you quickly total them up, please? What is the total of these scores which you have given to these 14 questions? Keep it to yourself. You don't have to share with anybody. You have your own total. I hope you are still capable of totaling without using a phone or a calculator. Right. Now I will explain to you and you can form an opinion by yourself. If you have scored anywhere maximum up to 18, 19, below 20, that is, anything below 20 is fine. You have learned how to balance life, how to take care of, you know, your various commitments and stresses and all that thing. So hopefully those of you who have managed to get scores which are below 20, say 14, 16, 18, like that. Congratulations to you. The moment your score starts crossing 20, and maybe somewhere between 20 to 25, let us say, it shows that you need to have caution. I'm not saying you're stressed out, but you need to be a little more cautious because you've just crossed that line. Prevention is better than cure, as I told you. Certain negative things happen, something happens to you, and it may get worse. So this is the time to prevent your stresses going up. But if your score has crossed 25, 30, 34, 32, whatever it may be, then you really need to take help. I think somewhere you have been neglecting this aspect of your life. Somebody is saying, my husband gives me all the stress. I will say no comments. Okay. By chance, I hope none of you out there have had a score, say, touching 35 or beyond. If you have, I'm not joking, please do something about it immediately. You can have very bad effects. You may not even realize. Some people, you know, land up with a cardiac problem. Some people land up with stroke. Some people land up with a nervous breakdown and all that. So if you are 35 and above, then please be, not 35 years, 35 score of those you know, questions which you have given, please take it immediately. But even if you are 25 plus, I think you need to do. It's not an emergency. It's not like that. So as I told you, this is not a psychometric test. It's not meant to put labels on people and all that. That's why I said you do it for yourself. It's a self-introspection exercise where it's a, like a wake-up call. So depending on where you stand, you have to take a call and decide what you want to do about it and how you can prevent these things in favor. Yes. What if I know that the stress has caused in the last month and should I still be worried? Yes. Because as I told you, stress is cumulative. So even if it has happened in the last 1 month, it has added on to the small, small stresses which you are already facing. So again, like I said, use it as a wake-up call. Okay, how to do it? I have been giving you some tips. At the same time, the second part of it, which I did not go too much into detail, but we will answer now based on that. What was the cause? What happened in the last 1 month which increased my stress levels so much? There again, the basic thing, some of those things I can handle, some of those I cannot handle. Some of them are beyond me. Those which are beyond me, I have to learn to cope. There is a good proverb that says that the best people are those who learn to deal with stress with the least distress. Here is Sunita showing you the effects of the stress on the entire body from top to bottom. Everything gets affected. So you don't know which vulnerable part of your body, whether you'll end up with a heart attack or a headache or a heartburn or high blood pressure or so many things. And this is only a representative list. There can be so many other things which are directly aggravated by stress. I'm not saying that they are caused by stress, but they get aggravated by stress. And this is what I told you in the morning. Use stress with a good stress, going all the way down to distress, where you have this extreme anxiety, sorrow, pain, confusion, and all these type of things. So as I told you, I'm repeating again, deal with it at two levels. The first one is the day-to-day thing, for which I gave you a representative list of about 10-15 possible ways in which you can do it. Be innovative and find out your own. I remembered a friend of mine who had a nasty boss who used to give him all the stress most of the time. What he did was that he got himself a permanent marker pen and wrote the name of his boss on the sole of his shoe. Now, whenever he's sitting in the office and the boss shouts at him or something of that sort, he just stamps his feet and, you know, squeezes his leg, knowing that below that is the boss. There are times when he got so angry with the boss, he stepped out of the office, looked for some cow dung, and went and purposely put his shoe into that. He said, I will have to wash it later. I don't mind doing it. But I want this bloody son of a so-and-so, so-and-so to be inside that cow dung, that sort of thing. And it worked. It works for him. That's what I said, that if you're innovative, you can find ways and means. Keep doing it on a regular basis. The moment you find one thing which helps, keep a note of it and use it as much as possible. Sometimes the thing which had helped earlier is not helping you now. Drop it and move on to something else. So that is the day-to-day management of stress. The other part of it, as I told you, is to deal with what are these stressors, what causes the stress. Yes, Satyan, a little bit of stress is good to build immunity against all good times. All that. That is what I was being mentioning as use stress. Without use stress, you will not perform. You will not be able to understand the nuances of life and all that. So we cannot categorically say that stress is bad. That's what I've been saying. Now, coming back to what I was telling you, that you also need to deal with this on a long-term basis. And what is that? That is to go into the root cause of what is causing me stress. Then sit and see whether I can resolve it. It could even be in the past. Remember, I have been hurt by somebody. That somebody has gone, moved on. But that somebody has left me with a lot of stress. I can still resolve it in my mind. If it is to do with a relationship, if it is to do with finances, if it is to do with anything, Can I work on that to resolve it? But every issue is not resolvable. So after having put in all your efforts, if you think, no, this does not work, I cannot find a solution, it is beyond me, then learn methods of coping, accepting it. That while I've had a lot of good things, in fact, list down all the good things that have happened to you to counterbalance and say, while life has treated me beautifully in this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 things, life has also treated me horribly in this one or two things which are hurting and for which I don't have a solution. Once you do that, then you can balance things out. One thing which I want to caution you about is people who look for shortcuts to get out of stress. People who take to chemical substances. I casually mentioned it, but I'm going deeper to tell you, people who say that I have one or two drinks and then I feel nice. People who say I smoke a cigarette and I feel nice. Going on to people who are into different forms of, you know, psychotropic substances, which are referred to as drugs, you know. It could be weed, ganja, those type of things. There are people who somehow seem to think that this will help me because it gives me a relief. Sorry to disappoint, it does not give relief. It postpones relief. And it comes back with a bang. The easiest indicator of that is the hangover which a person gets after getting drunk. So he has had a horrible day. His mind is super agitated. He is feeling angry, irritated. He goes and starts binge drinking. And as he has drink after drink, he starts feeling lighter, calmer, relaxed. Till he finally goes off to sleep. And he thinks, see, I've achieved this. He gets up in the morning and he's got this horrible hangover. And next day is going bad. And if this pattern continues, he needs more and more drinks. Same thing happens with sleeping tablets. People who say that, you know, I don't get sleep and that increases my stress. The whole day goes bad. So they start resorting to sleeping tablets. Initially, they feel very nice. I took this tablet and I peacefully went off and I slept the whole night and things looked better in the morning. But the more you keep taking these artificial means, the more you start getting immune to it. In fact, mental health professionals will tell you that there is a thing called drug-induced amnesia, insomnia. That means there are certain drugs like sleeping tablets, which if you take too regularly, they induce insomnia. They actually prevent you from having a peaceful sleep. Things can be that bad. Please keep that in mind. Yes, here is another slide which Sunita has been really quite creative in pulling these things out. Stress and drug relapse, what happens when you use drugs, you know, as a means of trying to get away from things, it can have horrible effects. So it's better to tolerate, accept, cope with some of these stressors, and you will find that over a period of time, slowly, you will find things which help you to, you know, relax without you are looking at shortcuts. Since we are talking about primarily stress about women, you ladies must have seen that the man in your life, if you have an argument with a person and that man just walks off when you're having a discussion or an argument, he goes off into his cave, and that can be very upsetting to a woman, and that can leave the woman very dissatisfied, very restless, because this man has just disappeared. He has not sat down and argued it out or fought it out. Learn to understand that this is how the caveman of modern era is. Get your stress out by some other means rather than chasing him and making him talk. Sometimes you may not succeed in that. Raji is asking, what causes OCD? That's a very complex question, Raji. If you can call me or mail me, I'll reply to you, because that's not really part of today's topic, so I will not disturb the other people's minds with that sort of thing. Dust and dirt stresses too much. Yes, some people have triggers, but there is stress inside you. Please understand that. The dust or dirt aggravates something which is already inherent inside you. So it is not the dust and dirt which is causing your stress. It is only bringing out suppressed stress. In fact, I always tell that the people who are in the worst situation, for whom I am very deeply concerned, are people who say, I am never stressed out. I do not have any stress at all. I can handle any challenge in life. It makes no difference to me. Two things happen. One is, they are passing the buck. You will inevitably find their people around, maybe their loved ones, their family members, or those type of people who are at the receiving end of this person's stress. So this person is just passing on what should have been his or her stress to the others. The second is that by being in denial, you are not even conscious of how it is affecting you. Till one fine day, you will realize that it has had a very bad effect. How many times I have come across people who have lived this very high-flying life, and one fine day they land up with a severe cardiac problem and they are in the intensive cardiac care unit of a huge hospital and this and that, and then they wake up to the fact that, hey, what was I doing all these years? Pretending that I am not stressed out, I can handle this, I can handle that. So denial of stress is one of the most dangerous thing I want you to keep in mind. And I'm again addressing the ladies today, that you will find some men in your life who tend to have, maybe it's ego, maybe it's whatever, it's like, not going to that, but there are a lot of men, compared to women, there are more men who tend to have this thing of denial. It's supposed to be a macho thing to say, I am a man, I can handle whatever it is. I have done it so many times. I have taken up this challenge. I have done that in my professional life and things of that sort. That way, comparatively, hats off to the women. They are much, much more realistic. Please continue to be realistic. Don't copy the men and the way they are doing it. Try and, as far as possible, teach, inculcate it to the men who are in your life. If it is not possible to inculcate it in people like, you know, who are your father, husband, brother, or those type of adults, please do it at least with the youngsters. If there are young boys, help them to understand that when you grow up and when you become a man, these are the possible things that you are going to be, you know, facing and you are going to be having to cope with. So learn how to overcome, how to deal with these things now. I feel overall, in general, when we talk about society as a whole, women have a great role to play in de-stressing people in general. Women can play a very significant role. Yes, Navina, I agree with you. I think it's better to encourage people around to talk about themselves, especially when they say, I do not have stress. Yes, come on, tell me about everything that is happening. We do it very often, you know, it's almost hilarious. This guy who says that I just don't have any stress and stuff like that, it's okay, tell me, what are you doing? Oh, I manage this, you know, I am the senior vice president and South Asia head of this $2 billion company. We have 5 verticals and 4 horizontals, and we have end-to-end 360 degrees problems, and something, he starts off with that. And believe me, within 1, 2, 3, 4 minutes, he starts talking about how he is overworked, how his bosses never appreciate him, how he is perpetually on the run. And slowly you can complete the whole cycle and bring him back to the point that this is the definition of stress. It's okay for you to say that I can manage. Nobody is doubting your capability. But if you have stress, you have stress. It is like, you know, hypertension. If I have high blood pressure, I have high blood. I can manage it. There are medical ways, there are non-medical ways of doing it. But for that, I first have to accept that I'm a hypertensive. My blood pressure is higher than what should normally be. The same thing applies to stress. Surekha is asking, those stresses cumulative, is it possible to bring down those? Yes, that is definitely possible. And you have to use that same double method which I mentioned. One is to deal with it on a day-to-day basis so that on a regular daily routine, your stress comes down to some extent. And then tackle the main issues which accumulated all the stress over the years. I agree with Dharnish that writing a diary also helps in managing stress. That's a wonderful way of de-stressing yourself. Those of you who have used to write a diary, give up those things, please get back to those type of thing. I also agree with Navina, who says that being empathic, being non-judgmental, giving positive strokes, encourage people to talk. And the last point that I would like to say is what I keep on harping and nobody agrees with me, and that is, if you get stressed out, if you are not able to maintain good relationships, if you are, perpetually caught up in that web of the rat race and things of that sort, you are headed towards becoming a more and more lonely person. If you have not read the media reports, 3 days back, the government of Japan appointed a minister for loneliness. United Kingdom did it in 2018. More than 2.5 years back. Now Japan has followed suit. They have acknowledged the fact that there are too many suicides, there are too many people who are getting in, lonely and stuff like that, and stress plays a very important role. All the things that I've been talking about will help you to manage and create a better quality of life. That's why our slogan has been empowering people by enriching their own lives. And that is what Sunita will tell you as she winds up today's program.
Okay, rookie mistake. I'm on mute. All right. Okay, so I was just saying thank you very much for joining us on this Saturday morning. Okay, we had a lovely time talking about stress. And of course, since it was more about Women's Day, we wanted to focus on stress for women. But the point is that stress is common across the gender, and all of us feel it. Similarly, there might be other topics that you wish to hear. Other topics which you might want Dr. Ali Khwaja to talk about. So do write to us on our email ID or send us a message on our mobile numbers, which we have displayed out here, or give us a call and tell what topic you'd like to hear about, and we will ensure that we have a live session on that topic. All right. And apart from that, Seema did tell you about the life skills course that we have, which is getting inaugurated tomorrow morning. So there's still time, and I'm sharing Seema's number here on the screen. Do message her. Without even joining the course, you can still participate in the inauguration to understand more about what life skills are and how it would be beneficial for you. So tomorrow, if you wish to join the live inauguration, please reach out to Seema. Her number is on the screen, and send out a message that you would like to join. We will send you a Google Meet link. All right. So I'm going to wrap up the session with the slides that we've been showing all through the live program. Please stay back and see the slides. Thank you very much. Have a lovely day.
Thank you.